Hey everybody, got a weird little one here that I wonder how many of you picked up back in the day or even remember. The Art of Homage Studios. I remember seeing this. I'm like, oh my gosh, because I like to draw comics even back then, back in the day. I knew that's what I wanted to do. And a book that was just the art of these guys. Well, hell yeah, I gotta have that. I mean, I don't think it was worth the $5 price tag, but what the hell do I know? But let's see, this was printed in 93. So I kind of forgot that I had this thing. I dug it out when I was digging through all my books and I found this thing and I'm like, oh yeah, this is something that needs a little bit of a spotlight. We got to look at this guy. So A Brief History of Homage Studios by Jeff Merritt. He kind of goes over different things with the studio, and there was like this like little layout of the way their office studios were done, like different areas where like different people would work. What a fun environment it must have been, like the Extreme Studios or the Top Cow guys or the, you know, the Homage Studios guys, where you all work together in an office. You're surrounded by artists all working on comics. You got writers, pencilers, inkers, colorists, letterers, the boss, Jim Lee in the case of this. Everyone in the same office. Like, I would imagine the creative energy that must have been there for a while was just insane. How awesome would it have been to, you know, be part of that? But let's just kind of flip through this thing real quick. It's basically, it's just a pinup book of different characters by different artists. This is Mark Silvestri. Pencils, Mark Silvestri. Inks by Silvestri and Tom McWeeny. Colors by Joe Chiodo. And just different characters from a character Strike Force that he wants to do with, you know, a book in the future. Wills Potasio doing Wet Works. This is one of the first image that maybe we ever saw these characters. I'm not sure on that. And he's himself, Wills Potasio, is saying here he got tired of watching what the guys were doing with the coloring. He got tired of watching what they were doing on the machines and decided to try coloring my own piece. I think computer separation and the photorealistic effects you can get is the cutting edge future of comics. And so I guess he colored this himself. And it looks really good. This is one of my favorite images of these characters. This giant guy carrying these giant guns and the effects on that. I mean, it looks really cool. It works for me. Inker Scott Williams does this character, White Wolf. I don't think that's anything that ever became anything, but something that he was kind of thinking about. This is Jim Lee talking about here. He says, with the advent of so much crosshatched uplighting, I decided to try something different and use as little parallel line rendering as possible. So you can kind of tell it's just more like the basic line work. It looks almost kind of like trying to draw in an animated style, which is all right. Just a big monster guy. This is funny. This is art by J. Scott Campbell. Story by, it says J. Pat C. and J. Scott Campbell. Cap'n Pyro and the West Coast Pirates. This thing is so similar to what he did with Gen 13 and his kind of J. Scott Campbell's interest and style and like lighthearted kind of fun comics. It's like a total cliche. A knowing cliche of the most ridiculous kind of things that you can come up with in comics. Like it says, Cap'n Pyro and the West Coast Pirates. And this guy, he's like, howdy, I am William Murdoch, but my friends call me Wild Bill Cody. This here is my team and our story. And don't let the looks fool you. These kids are tops in what they do. And you got the hot girl and the weird animalistic guy and the mysterious guy, the giant muscly guy and a tech guy and another hot girl and the heroic leader. Like, you've seen every version of these characters in every Image Comics super team ever, especially like the Wild or the Extreme Studios nonsense. And it's funny because it's like J. Scott Campbell's like, they're making fun of that shit. It's so obvious. You know, it's such a cliche thing. And they're like, we're going to make fun of it. So it continues on. And it's funny. It's got a real funny sense of humor. Roll call, folks. Cap'n Duke Pyro, a leader, an all-American hero. Snake Remick, a smart-mouthed and whip-cracking gunslinger from out of the West. Heidi Grogan, the beauty on the waves, wherever they may be. Like, they don't even talk about her powers or anything. She's just hot. Okay. Jack Knife, the man with the plan, laddies, and it's all in the hands. Dradicus, the badass from Kairos, I think. Pantera, he isn't just another pretty face. Shonda Tritson, another beauty who's in command, who's a natural beauty who's in command of nature. And then Warchild Tritson, the younger and spunkier of the two. Her powers are young, but her ambition is high. And here's Peter James, my brother. He's the money man of the outfit. And so it's like, feel the action. He's like, don't call me Barney, as he smashes a guy. Visit the beach. Come back to St. Lupus. Live the adventure. It's like the girl's yelling, look out for that mountain. I see it, lass, I see it. It's so great. Take on fiendish foes. And they've just got like this collection of ridiculous, monstrous villain guys. Experience the romance. Baby, you make my bacon sizzle. He's like, oh, Snake. Don't let the adventure pass you by. And the end with a question mark. This is probably the single most creative thing in this whole fucking book. Like this thing right here. Like, they drew up a couple of pages of some funny, humorous, cliche, well done, interesting concepts. That's just a jab at the entire kind of superhero kind of vibe going on at the time. It's just freaking great. And then you got stupid bad guy Pike from Wildcats. That's boring. And then this is Operation Urban Storm. It was a story first intended to appear in Operation Urban Storm, a benefit book to help rebuild Los Angeles after the April 92 riots. Due to various circumstances, the book was postponed. The story was still timely and noteworthy as my first pencil and ink project in some time. So that's Jim Lee penciling and inking himself. It's the characters from Stormwatch. You know, they're like helping out with the LA riots were going on and trying to be superheroes in a real world situation. It's okay. Not really a big deal. Joe Madureira showing up here. He says, I know the pose is goofy, but I'm just psyched that I get a chance to draw my favorite Image character. I love fast women. And that's a pretty cool pose and good anatomy. And, you know, it's a little silly, but it works. So very cool. Mark Silvestri presents Weapon Zero. And so this is just another, like, I don't know if it's like a proof of concept, a couple of pages, or if these were actually printed in the book. But like the first look at a book coming out from the Top Cow guys, even though this was before I think Top Cow ever existed. But I know who the artist is that drew the book, but is it Joe Benitez? I think it's who it is, but I don't know what they're showing it. This guy, the artist, he can draw. He was really going for it. He's got some skills. And again, like a lot of those early artists, he looks like a knockoff version of the guys he works for. This guy, I think it's Joe Benitez, I do believe. And he was kind of a Silvestri clone. But again, he's another one of those artists that come into his own and became a great artist in his own right. And he's fantastic these days. And he's incredible. But I mean, look at these giant, weird, mutated, overly muscly legs. But he had something that was really cool. This, How to Draw by Wills Pertassio. This is weird because it says How to Draw by Wills Pertassio, but then it says somewhere, here's a page of Gen 13 plot written by Brandon Choi. Take a crack at laying it out yourself, then turn the page and see how Jim Lee handled it. So it's said by Wills Pertassio. Maybe he's writing this? But it says, the layout's by Jim Lee. Maybe this is Jim Lee doing like the basic quick sketchy, you know, drawing. Maybe he did this quick scribbly stuff. But when you get to the actual page, this is not Jim Lee. This is J. Scott Campbell. So it's not Pertassio. It's not Jim Lee. It's J. Scott Campbell. There were some interesting things on here. It's hard to really give artistic, like, lessons in quick text boxes in any way that actually really helps. You really need somebody to show you. That's fine. It all worked out. It was neat to see a page, you know, from the beginning stages, you know, from really rough, super rough layouts like this, and then getting to see how it looks in the final stages. It's pretty awesome. But I like J. Scott Campbell, but not this early version of him. I've said that before. That's all right. Oh boy, swimsuits. I've did a couple videos on some swimsuit editions from all these studios. It's always kind of funny. I like this one because it's Jim Lee talking about the artist J. Scott Campbell. J. Scott Campbell has a graceful, playful style which combines the attention of detail of such great artists as Arthur Adams with the stylistic gestures of the very best Disney animators. While meticulous, his work is uncluttered yet detailed. Already attracting notice, J. Scott and his characters will definitely be turning some heads in the near future. And he was not wrong. They did Gen 13, and that was a huge success. This is Jim Lee talking about Aaron Weisenfeld. I did a video of Aaron Weisenfeld's Deathblow Wolverine. It's one of the coolest books you'll ever see artistically. That guy that drew that book, this looks nothing like the way the artist that he turned into. That's funny because I just did a video very recently. In fact, if you're watching this, these are probably one right after another. But I did a video on this guy, Dan Panosian, and I was talking about, tell me an artist who progressed in skill level as much as Panosian did from where he started to where he is today. Aaron Weisenfeld, the way he drew here versus the way he drew in that Wolverine Deathblow, he's out of comics now. He's like a fine artist painter. Totally different guy. So it's interesting to see a guy going through so many levels and so many stages in his artistic abilities in his career. This shit is like okay from early Image comic stuff, but again, it's like Jim Lee clone wannabe, and it's not any good. And it's a hard angle to draw, but that face sucks. Like, it's hard. It's hard to do. So he was going for it, and Aaron Weisenfeld is a guy that's hardcore into detail, and you can see that he definitely had it in here. Like, this is one of the things I thought was funny with the Warblade character. He's like a liquid metal body. He's got his, you know, thumb sticking out there with a bunch of hot dogs on it. I do not get this. Why would the character Void, who runs around in this silver, like, body sheath thing, put a bikini over her silver body sheath outfit? Because you can see kind of like her face is her human skin. So she's got skin and then a silver body thing over it and then a bikini over that. Doesn't make no damn sense. And this just stupid grifter just sitting there with his mask on. He was going for it. Like super, super early work from the guy, but it kind of, it's not that good. Ryan Benjamin, he's pretty good. This is Jim Lee drawing the Gen 13 characters and dinosaurs. That's really good. Another brand. So the Strike Force characters, but with Brandon Peterson drawing, he's not great here, but he becomes really, really good, and it doesn't take him very long to get good. But I don't think this book was anything that great. I like this part, Scott Clark showing some pencil rendering drawings. Like, as he says here, I saw this as an opportunity to revert back to the drawing style I used in school. Rendering in grays gives you a little more freedom because you're not worrying about what you have to give to an inker. Here's some loose sketches to give you an idea. So it's neat to see some like pencil sketches from a guy. That ripcloth face looks great. That profile's all right. I really like that one. That one's really good. Another kind of sexy, classic, old school kind of vibe there. That's really neat. Mark Silvestri sketchbook. It's funny, they reprinted all these sketches here in that Cyber Force collected book. So we've seen all this stuff. That Psyblade, I said it before, I'll say it again. It looks pretty damn good. She's pretty sexy. Wills Potassio, man, this guy, he loves heavy shadows and rendering and lighting. And man, just the ability to draw this kind of like muscle mass. It looks like layered, thick, meaty tissue layered upon layers of itself. It's so neat. I love that so much. This is one of the things I really liked about that. I'm like, holy shit, just look at this pencil drawing. So talking about artist Brett Booth there, these were some characters of his own. He says he would like to do a book on these guys. I'm sure it would have been god awful because again, it's another superhero team of like the leader guy and the hot girl and the monster girl and the mysterious guy, and it's just so cliche. I don't know what the hook would have been, his unique spin on these characters. It could have been interesting, but probably not. And then a little back page artwork. And then this was How to Break into Comics. Like, tells you what you need to know. Practice a lot. Send your submissions to an editor. Show your work at conventions. Show us that you can tell a story. Don't just do pinups. Don't just draw this. Show a story. Tell a story in panels and pages. Take criticism. Important stuff. And, I mean, that's it. So, it's pretty interesting. A neat little thing they put up back in the day for, again, $5. I don't know why it had to be so damn expensive, but just a fun little random thing from the explosive, interesting early 90s Image Comics nonsense that was going on that we are all there and we all loved so much. So just a quick thing to look at. Thanks for joining me. I appreciate it very much, and I will see you again soon.